It is my pleasure to introduce our three speakers for this afternoon as we talk about the earthly paradise at Clouds Hill. Martin Gething has lived near Clouds Hill for over 40 years. 6 years ago, when he retired from a career as a research scientist in the UK Ministry of Defense, he started volunteering as a guide at the cottage and has been fascinated ever since, not only in the life of Lawrence of Arabia, but also in the history of Clouds Hill. After Martin, we'll be speaking Neill Child. He's a retired civil servant with a lifelong interest in history. His grandfather, a soldier in the Palestine campaign, sparked his interest in Lawrence's world, of which he has written various articles. And closing us out will be Tony Gill. He was born and brought up in Dorset and since 2015 has worked for the National Trust at Clouds Hill and at two Thomas Hardy homes nearby. Along with Martin and Neill, he has been conducting research into Lawrence and Clouds Hill, which is still ongoing and, in his words, seemingly never ending. It is a delight to be in conversation with you all and friends among our audience. Remember, we do always take questions in the chat, but it's great if we get them in the Q&A after about 45 minutes of our panel conversation. We'll be taking questions from there. Martin, the microphone is all yours, sir.
Okay, thank you very much, Laura. There we go. Am I sharing screen or are you doing it for me? There we go. Okay, so the earthly paradise at Clouds Hill. As Laura said, it will be myself followed by Neill and Tony. I'll start out by explaining a little bit about Lawrence of Arabia, not very much, but just an introduction, and explain why he ended up in Dorset and at this particular cottage. Neill will then look at some first-hand accounts of what the cottage was like from some writers and artists from books they published. And then the third one of us will be Tony, who will talk about the way that Lawrence of Arabia transformed the cottage ready for his retirement. But first we need to start with an introduction to where Clouds Hill is and what it is. So here we are on the south coast of England in Dorset. There's a closer up map. And just to make sure the key places are highlighted, we have Bovington, which is the army camp that Lawrence joined and where he was based. And they're famous for their tanks. They've got one of the largest tank museums in the world. Morton is where Lawrence's funeral was held and where his grave is. And Dorchester is where the writer Thomas Hardy lived, who Lawrence visited many, many times on his motorcycle when he was staying at Clouds Hill. The cottage itself now is looked after by the National Trust, and this is what it looks like these days. When Lawrence first saw it, as we'll be explaining later, it needed a lot of repairs. It didn't look anything like this. It was pretty well run down and falling apart. But he gradually transformed it over the 12 years that he was using the cottage. And Tony will go through each of these rooms in turn and explain what they were. But basically, the top left, we have the upstairs sitting room where he could entertain his visitors and where he could read and write in peace away from the noise of the barracks. Top right is a visitor's room with a bunk bed in it, which he also uses as his pantry, which is why there's a glass jar there with some food underneath it. Bottom left is the downstairs book room, which was originally the kitchen, but he decided he didn't need a kitchen, so he wanted floor to ceiling bookshelves. And then the last room, which was a very late change to the house, is he added a bathroom. So that's what the cottage looks like now. So let's go back to Lawrence. Lawrence actually became a media celebrity in the 1920s. Famed for the heroic part he played in the Arab revolt during the First World War, without which Britain and her allies would not have overcome the Turkish Ottoman Empire in the Middle East so easily or so decisively. Lawrence became a glamorous romantic figure surrounded by mystery and enigma. He actually hated it. He was a scholar and an archaeologist by training, with a first-class degree in history from Oxford University. He preferred being an unnoticed person in the background, but he had a powerful intellect and an incisive mind, which meant he quite often found himself stepping forwards and taking command. He relished independence. In his famous capture of the Red Sea port of Aqaba, after an eight-week trek across the Forbidding Desert, which was made famous in David Lean's 1962 Lawrence of Arabia movie, this trek was made without the knowledge of his army superiors. After the war ended, Lawrence was made a media celebrity by the American reporter and showman Lowell Thomas, who's seen in the top right photograph here, who created the Lawrence of Arabia myth. He put on shows daily in London, and he, on the right-hand side, you see a show bill from the Royal Albert Hall, which he was filling daily, and it performed for months on end to packed audiences around London, around Britain, and then around the world. At first, Lawrence was fascinated by it. Then he became tolerant, but afterwards he quickly became exasperated and embarrassed by the publicity. Suffering from battlefield stress, coupled with guilt and depression about the way Britain had failed to meet its promises to the Arabs, in 1922, Lawrence decided to get away from his fame by completely disappearing from public life. He changed his name and he joined the RAF in 1922. And then 6 months later, he transferred into the army at the tank corps at Bovington. For him, the anonymity of the ordinary soldier was the equivalent of retreating to the cloisters in a medieval monastery. It gave him a place where he could work without thinking, without decision-making, without any external expectations. And it gave him a place where he could recover his shattered mind. And gradually, over the following years, he became more and more relaxed and at ease with himself. So, 1923, 100 years ago, Lawrence arrived in Dorset to join the tank corps. We actually have his enlistment record here, which I've highlighted in red. And so it's labelled Thomas Edward Shaw. He had changed his name to avoid the publicity, although you'll notice underneath somebody's written alias Lawrence. He joined on the 12th of March, 1923, as I say, a century ago. Now, the army camp at Bovington had actually been started before the war, but it quickly expanded greatly during the First World War. And here's a map of it in 1915. Most of the buildings you see here are single-story wooden huts. During the 1920s, when Lawrence arrived, the camp had actually expanded even more. So here's some early photographs of it. Soldiers marching on the left, and on the right, you can see the wooden huts disappearing off to the horizon, apparently, but large numbers of wooden huts there. Gradually, with the army camp there, there were some other buildings that grew up, the civilian run shops, garage, restaurants and cafes. And in fact, the soldiers quite often preferred to use these cafes and restaurants than the army mess, that they could get better quality food there. Even though they had to pay for it, they were willing to do so. And in fact, when Lawrence was living at Clouds Hill, he would quite often go down to Bovington to get a meal there rather than cook anything for himself. So in 1923, he arrived apparently as a new recruit. He changed his name, he disguised his age. He hadn't claimed any previous military service. So he was there as a new recruit. And for the first few months, new recruits were actually confined to camp while they did their initial training. So just 10 days or so after Lawrence had arrived, he wrote a letter describing the place. The camp is beautifully put, a wide heath of flint and sand with pines and oaks, and much rhododendron coming slowly into bloom. One of my sorrows is the recruits course. New name, naturally, new age, no previous service, and consequent imprisonment in the camp for a month. In April, he then wrote again, the camp authorities are very narrow towards us recruits, giving no leave till August and few spare afternoons. Lawrence did actually decide he would escape for an afternoon, and he went off to visit Thomas Hardy in Dorchester. He'd not met him yet, so he had an introduction from Robert Graves and went over on his motorbike and met Thomas Hardy and his wife for the first time. Next day, he wrote to a friend, I saw Hardy yesterday, paid for seeing him too, for it meant cutting a parade. However, it was worth it. So the penalty he had was he had to do extra duties to make up for having missed the parade. However, by August, Lawrence had finished his initial training and he was then assigned to the quartermaster's stores where he had his evenings and weekends free. And here's an account from a fellow private, Alec Dixon. Lawrence was sent to work as a clerk in the stores. There he found life much more pleasant, so the work left his evenings and weekends free, and he was to some degree his own master. Having settled in his new quarters, he set to work revising the Oxford version of Seven Pillars of Wisdom. After several weeks, he told me he'd been searching beyond the camp boundary for rooms in which he might retire during his leisure hours. He invited me to appraise an excellent cottage that he had discovered hidden away among trees and rhododendrons of Clouds Hill. So what Lawrence wanted was somewhere quieter away from the noise of the barracks. We have another account from another soldier of first finding Clouds Hill. This is from Arthur Russell, who was in the same barrack block as Lawrence. He'd been to see Thomas Hardy, and on his way back, we used to cut through the back roads, and we used to pass Clouds Hill down the road where the cottage is. And we stopped there one day, and he said, "Want to have a look at something?" So we walked down and saw this cottage, practically no roof on it. It was derelict. He said, "A relative of mine, as far as I know, owns this. I'll go and see her about it if I can have it. I'll go and see her now. She only lives down the road." I walked back to camp. I hadn't been there long when he said, "We've got it." Not, "I've got it," but "we've got it." I was always included with him in everything. So this is what the Clouds Hill was initially looking like. In fact, when Lawrence first saw it, it needed a roof repaired, but this is basically what it looked like, completely surrounded by trees and bushes and rhododendrons. And you can see a very quiet spot on the heath side. Now, I'm actually going to jump forward 2 years, because in 1925, Lawrence's brother Arnold and his wife came to stay at the cottage, and they actually stayed for 6 months. And in August 1925, Arnold wrote to a friend, "It is very much in need of attention. We do anything from pulling off a ceiling to pruning rhododendron trees besides the small domestic cares. The place is now habitable, but still unsightly, and it will take the rest of the year to get it into a decent condition. And decent to us does not mean a great deal. Nobody who had not seen the awful mess of a month ago would think well of our present muddled surroundings. But as a matter of fact, we are progressing phenomenally, we think." So this is giving me an idea of how bad a condition the cottage was in and how long it took to get it sorted out, because this is 2 years after Lawrence first started renting it. Nevertheless, Lawrence had already started building up his collections of records and books, gramophone records and books, which were so important to him. And here in the centre, we have part of a list of the books at Clouds Hill in December 1926. So we know he was already collecting them. And elsewhere on this inventory, there's also some of the gramophone records that he'd collected. We'll come on more to his collections later. The collections he built up at the cottage over the years became quite large. When Lawrence died in 1935, he had a collection of about 200 gramophone records, all of them classical music, and he had between 12 and 1500 books in the book room. All of those were listed in an annex to a book published by his brother Arnold, T. Lawrence by his friends. So that's giving you an idea of how he first found the cottage and what condition it was in. I'll now hand over to Neill Childs, who will give some first-hand accounts of the life in the cottage.
Right. Get on to sharing my screen. There we are. Oh. Good afternoon and good evening, as I think it's both for many of people. Lawrence had from an early in his life taken a great interest in literature, particularly poetry. He was a great reader of a wide variety of books and authors. And so it was that his wartime fame gave him the opportunity to meet and mingle with some of the great writers of his day. However, we begin with a man Lawrence met at Bovington, not maybe a famous writer, but subsequently a published author. Alec Dixon, who we've heard of from Martin, had joined the Tank Corps in 1919, preferring the potential excitement to his job as a bank clerk. Initially at Wergrat Camp, then a Tank Corps depot about 3 miles from Bovington, he was transferred to the latter camp and there befriended Lawrence, or Shaw, as he was by then called. They discovered a common interest in books and writing, and Dixon showed Lawrence his short stories, appreciating his critical but helpful remarks. But it wasn't until a short time after that, on an outing to Salisbury, that Shaw revealed that he was Lawrence. One day, Lawrence invited Dixon to visit an excellent cottage he had discovered. Dixon wrote of this in his book about his army experiences, the one you see there, cleverly titled Tinned Soldier. He said, "I laughed when I saw the place, for its roof was a mere skeleton of rafters, and the staircase swayed dangerously as we climbed to inspect the flawless upper room. The foundations are good," said Lawrence solemnly, "and I like the windows. I spent a good deal of my spare time at Clouds Hill, reading, writing, talking with other soldier friends. It was Shaw's delight to preside over the company, feeding the gramophone, stoking the fire, and keeping everyone present in excellent humour. We had picnic meals at all hours and washed them down with draughts of China tea." Dixon, after leaving the Tank Corps, published 2 other books, Singapore Patrol, about his time in the police in Singapore, and a novel, Extreme Occasion. In 1918, Winston Churchill's secretary, Edward Marsh, had introduced Lawrence to Siegfried Sassoon, a poet who later achieved greater fame both through poetry and his book of war experiences, Memoirs of a Fox Hunting Man. But in 1918 was already celebrated for his collection of war poems, Counterattack, published earlier in that year. It was this book that had prompted Lawrence to ask for an introduction. Sassoon was his first contact with the literary world of post-war Britain and remained a friend for life. In 1923, Siegfried Sassoon, with Lawrence's permission, had sent a draft of 7 Pillars of Wisdom to the novelist E.M. Forster for his appraisal. Edward Morgan Forster, known to all as Morgan, had by then published A Room with a View and Howard's End. He had first met Lawrence in person in 1921 at a lunch for Emir Faisal. Forster was excited to meet Lawrence and subsequently wrote to him, but received no reply at that time. In response to receiving 7 Pillars, he sent Lawrence a long and constructive critique of the work, which was greatly appreciated by Lawrence. In March 1924, he invited Forster down for a visit. Forster wrote of the experience in a letter to a friend. "Today, I went to his cottage by car. He shares it with 2 other private soldiers, also Little. They spend their leisure there, but have to sleep in camp. A charming place in the hollow of Egdon Heath, described by Thomas Hardy in The Return of the Native. It is all among rhododendrons which have gone wild. We worked on his book and then had lunch on our knees, cold chicken and ham, stewed pears and cream, very nice, a fine log fire. I like L, although of course he is odd and alarming. After a walk, we returned to tea and a most beautiful gramophone. The two other private soldiers mentioned were most likely Edward Palmer, known as Posh, and Arthur Russell. Later of that year, in August, Sassoon himself finally paid a visit to Clouds Hill, accompanied by a friend, John Philbin. He wrote an account in his diary. We overtook the little man just beyond the camp, on his way up to his cottage, with a towel rolled under his arm. He hopped up on the car. In a few hundred yards, we were at the cottage, a tiny four-roomed house surrounded by rhododendrons and a fine old ilex. It had been described to me by EMF Forster. The outer walls were yellow, although Hardy, who went there to tea, suggested duck egg green. There was a kitchen on the ground floor, and up some stairs, a small roof convex chamber containing four shelves of books, a fine gramophone, and a lot of records, an old leather sofa, a table, and a dark half-luster tea service made by a local potter. Before entering the house, we climbed the bank and looked at the wooded view towards Dorchester. T.E.L. said, "You will find a fragment of the tank corps inside. He has a strong country accent and doesn't say much. He's called Russell." I had heard of little Russell from EMF. He appears to be the Patroclus of the piece. That tea party in the little house among the rhododendrons on Egdon Heath will remain a cherished memory. And he is obviously getting very fond of his cottage. Patroclus, to jog the collected memories, was the close companion of Achilles. In August 1925, Gilbert Spencer, the artist, came to stay at the cottage. Lawrence was deeply interested in the wartime generation of artists, and Gilbert was one of those commissioned by him to provide the artwork for the subscriber's edition of Seven Pillars of Wisdom. His brother Stanley Spencer is more famous, but Gilbert was a respected landscape and portrait artist. In his book, Memoirs of a Painter, he described his first view of the place. We entered a sizable room on our left and were greeted by a string of oaths from some soldiers who were plastering the ceiling. Some of it had collapsed on top of them as a result of people walking about above. Lawrence next invited me to cross the passage to be shown the bathroom. There was nothing but dead wood inside. There seemed to be a tree growing up through the floor, holding up the roof floor of the room above. He showed me my bedroom. There was nothing in it except a freshly made army bed with nice clean sheets. On the other hand, there was a large space for a window, but no glass or window frame. And the ceiling was just laths, which Lawrence apparently had found particularly to his liking, so he had stopped the plasterers. Spencer left a painting of the view from the top of the hill, which Lawrence fitted as a panel over an upstairs window, which offered a view in the same direction. Ian Forster wrote a lovely memoir of subsequent visits to Clouds Hill in his collection, Two Cheers for Democracy, published in 1951. In particular, the four nights he spent there again in 1924. In those days, the two bottom rooms were full of firewood and lumber. We lived upstairs, and the sitting room there looks now much as it did then, although the gramophone and the books have gone, and the fender with its bent ironwork has been remodeled. It was, and it is, a brownish room. Wooden beams and ceiling, leather-covered settee. Here we talked, played Beethoven's symphonies, ate and drank. We drank water only, or tea. No alcohol ever entered Clouds Hill. We drank out of pretty cups of black pottery, and we ate out of tins. T.E. always laid in a stock of tin dainties for his guests. There were no fixed hours for meals. No one sat down. If you felt hungry, you opened a tin and drifted about with it. It was fine being alone at Clouds Hill at night, so silent. And those were the times when there was silence. And further, when Thomas Hardy turned up, for instance, as he did one sunny afternoon, he seemed to come on a visit to us all, and not specially to see his host. Thomas Hardy and Mrs. Hardy came up the narrow stairway into the little brown room, and there they were, the guests of us all. To think of Clouds Hill as T.E.'s home is to get the wrong idea of it. It was rather his pied-à-terre, the place where his feet touched the earth for a moment and found rest. And I will now hand you on to Tony Gill, who will continue the story.
Thank you, Neill. Thank you. Good afternoon and good evening, everyone. So I'll just talk about the later years, really the last 6 years of Lawrence's life at the cottage from 1929. His final years really coincided with the most significant renovations to the cottage. The closer he came to retirement, the more the tasks sort of piled up. When Lawrence was hastily returned from India in early 1929, he hadn't seen the cottage for over 2 years. His new posting would be at RAF Catwater. Sorry, my slide's not moving on. Should. Bear with me a second.
If you click on the screen, Tony, that should kick it off.
Thank you. Thank you, Martin. Glitch over. Yes, he hadn't seen Clouds Hill for 2 years, and he was at RAF Catwater in Plymouth, later being renamed Mountbatten. But he had overseas leave due. So he holed up in his old haunt at 14 Barton Street in London to escape the publicity caused by his return. But from either London or Plymouth, Clouds Hill still lay over 100 miles distant. There were other obstacles lay in the path of transforming the cottage into a vision of the place he wanted to retire to. Firstly, the cottage still had tenants. In Lawrence's absence, Clouds Hill was being rented to earn its keep. And a kitchen had therefore been installed downstairs, much to Lawrence's disapproval. And he reminded Sergeant Knowles, his neighbour overseeing alterations to the cottage, "I'm sure you will do nothing which cannot easily be broken away later." There were further complications in the fall of 1930 with the arrival at the cottage of Lawrence's mother, Sarah, and elder brother, Bob. Here they are. I think Sarah at this time was 97, this is in her final years. Like T.E., they were nomadic and restless, and somewhat unexpectedly, they stayed for nearly 2 years at the cottage, delaying his own very personal vision for the place. When they did finally leave, Lawrence butchered his elder brother's bed to make a large day couch, 6 feet square downstairs, and you'll see that later. Secondly, and more importantly, he was short of money and would soon sell land he owned north of London at a place called Pole Hill to purchase Clouds Hill. Lawrence was no longer going to be a tenant, but now an owner outright. He was also still working on a translation of Homer's Odyssey, the publication of which, perhaps more than any other single act, allowed Clouds Hill to be transformed. In December 1933, he wrote to American publisher F.N. Doubleday, "That USA Odyssey version brought me in $800. I have blown them all upon the ground floor of the cottage, installing a water heater, but no drain, a bath, a boiler, an oil heater, all in the one small room, and put in shelves, books, for books and an oak floor in the other, larger room. So now I have a cottage of four tiny rooms, one for sitting in, full of gramophone records, one for reading in, full of books, one for working in, fitted with a table and chair, one for washing in, fitted with a hot bath. No bedroom, no kitchen, no water closet. Only the rooms I would enjoy. I always say that, granted the luxuries in life, I can dispense with the essentials. Okay, so let's have a closer look at some of these modifications. And they were substantial. Let's begin in the main downstairs room. This is what we call the book room today. It was one permanent alteration Lawrence was keen to make here was the addition of bookcases to three sides of the downstairs room. His ever-expanding collection of reading material had outgrown both the main room upstairs and the generosity of friends, such as Vivian Richards, who had agreed to store many of them in their own homes. After the walls were treated with damp-proof cement, damp, after all, is not a healthy environment for fine books, the bookshelves were ordered through a local carpenter called Parsons, who had been recommended by Thomas Hardy's widow, Florence, and they were finally installed in December of 1933. Even today, one can see in Lawrence's own hand the instructions he left for their construction. It says something along the lines of, as left hand, side, 12 inch deep, shelving to ceiling, spaced as left hand side. A struggling bookseller, Kenneth Marshall, another short-term tenant at the cottage, was asked to arrange the books on the shelves and even to dispose of any dust jackets. This was something Lawrence found unsightly, dust jackets, didn't like them at all. Other changes made were new panes of glass in the large mullion window you can see at the end of the, on the gable end there. The central pane, now ingeniously pivoting open to help with the ventilation. These alterations to the window were so awkward that it took three generations of the same family of builders, the Bug family, to complete the task. The fireplace was now enlarged, a hood was installed, and a special reading chair to Lawrence's own specifications was commissioned in Southampton, where he was living in Diggs at the time. The reading chair is lovely. It's a striking sort of Art Deco triumph of function and simplicity. And it brings to mind his search for comfort many years earlier as he crossed the treacherous Wadi Sirhan during the Arabian campaign in 1917. As he wrote in Seven Pillars to Wisdom, my heaven might have been a lonely, soft armchair, a bookrest, and the works of the poets, hand set in Caslon, hand printed on the best paper. If we move across the small entrance lobby to the smaller room, this was to become Lawrence's bathroom. And for a man who often treated his body with contempt, Lawrence's wish for a hot bath was a rare concession. The walls, as you can see, were lined with Portuguese cork, and a porcelain enameled bath, iron bath, was purchased from one R.G. Goslett, who was an old acquaintance from the war. He'd been a stores officer in Aqaba. And again, to Lawrence's specifications, a Vulcan hydraulic ram was ordered to bring water from a natural spring 100 yards distant. And here you can actually see the invoices for each. There's the invoice for the bath and one from Mr. Bug, again, whose family had done the window, one for the ram. At the end of August 1933, when the ram was complete, Lawrence excitedly wrote to Charlotte Shaw, yesterday was a day. At 1:45 p.m., water, driven by the smallest ram ever installed anywhere, began to flow into my cottage. The single oldest and only inhabitant of Clouds Hill took off his RAF cap and collected the first pint in a mug. It arrived in 4 minutes. The taste was of red lead and galvanized iron. That's the view back from the bathroom. So you can see this, by the way, these black and white pictures you're seeing, they were taken shortly after Lawrence's death, we think, in sort of late 1935. And they're the most sort of contemporary ones we have for the cottage during his time there. If we now go upstairs, directly above the bathroom is another small room. And for many years, this served as a very basic guest bedroom, as we've heard. Lawrence intended to use the space as a workroom, but eventually built into it a bunk with drawers beneath for much needed storage. And always considerate to those who came to stay, he asked his neighbour, Henrietta Knowles, to make a pair of rudimentary sleeping bags. And across one of them, Lawrence stitched the word meum, mine, in Latin. And the one upstairs here for the guests, says tuum, or thine, yours. And that's the one downstairs. We show it downstairs now. So again, he was always the very convivial host. Late on, two further changes were made to the upstairs room. One was to sheave the walls in aluminium foil to keep it dry. And the other was to include a ship's porthole to add light and continue the nautical theme provided by the bunk bed. The porthole was sourced by one T.B. Marson, who had been private secretary to Hugh Trenchard, who was the chief of the air staff. And in recognition of this, Lawrence inscribed 1935 TBM DD in the wet cement. DD, we think, is a Latin abbreviation which sort of translates as gave this offering. If we now move across to the other larger room upstairs, what we now refer to as the music room, again, contemporary pictures. It's a very pleasing room. It's got a lovely warmth with the exposed beams. And this was the first room, as we've heard, to be used by Lawrence after the cottage was made watertight and re-roofed. And its primary purpose was a place where he could concentrate on translation work and make revisions to the manuscript of Seven Pillars of Wisdom. In October 1923, Lawrence sold his gold dagger that he'd been given during the Arabian campaign. He sold it to Lionel Curtis for £125. And this went, much needed money for repairs to the cottage. And straight away upstairs, he had a partition wall removed and the skylight you can just see in the corner there was put in. Furniture was secondhand. Again, it was functional and often disregarded. Apparently one day Lawrence's neighbour came in and found him scrubbing the table with a brick and some sand. Suffice to say, he was not impressed. Comfort also came second to practicalities, and on the rare occasions that we know Lawrence slept in the cottage, he would either find a spot on the floor or just choose to sleep fully clothed in a chair. Lawrence fashioned a mantelpiece, as you can see, above the fire, particularly for his short height, so he could rest an elbow on it. And the room was handsomely panelled. Between the panelling and the wall, there is a small cavity which Lawrence suggested should be partly filled with broken glass to make it awkward for mice. As downstairs, there was a leather door added to eliminate unwanted noise. And of course, there was plenty of solace to be found in the gramophone records. They were aired on this fabulous 1932 wind-up gin gramophone made in London, and it really dominates the room. Even today, it's almost the first thing that catches your eye when you walk in. And many happy an hour was spent listening to music in the company of fellow soldiers, the great and the good, or even what Lawrence referred to as a mixed grill, often soldiers and people like Thomas Hardy or Sassoon or whoever at the same time. And looking down upon this scene, Lawrence, as a patron of the arts as well, Lawrence referred to his dual masters. He had two portraits in the cottage. Little echoes, we think, of his former life. One was the Emir Faisal here, that was done by Augustus John. And at the other end of the room, there was General Allenby, done by Eric Kennington. And of course, the transformation of Clouds Hill didn't stop just with the rooms of the cottage. Outside and across the road, where his neighbours lived, they became his tenants, in effect, when he rented the land. And he had a large 7,000-gallon water tank dug to combat the very real threat of heath fires. Above the water tank, a greenhouse of sorts was constructed, as you can see. And at one end, he had an office. And this was with the intention of, sadly unrealised, of course, with his premature death. The intention was to print books here. The first was going to be an edition of his The Mint, his account of RAF days. If we move forward to his final weeks, on Wednesday, the 8th of May, 1935, just 5 days before his fatal motorcycle accident, he replied to Lady Astor and her invitation to come to Clifden and meet the soon-to-be Prime Minister Stanley Baldwin. He decided to decline her offer, as though the draw of his cottage was still too great, writing, as you can see here, "No, wild mares would not at present take me away from Clouds Hill. It is an earthly paradise, and I'm staying here till I feel qualified for it." Perhaps in the end, after all his exertions and wanderings, he wanted a simple retirement without cares or constraints, to sit still, as he would often say. A decade earlier, fellow soldiers had derided Clouds Hill, nicknaming it Fool's Paradise. Now, perhaps, it was the enduring appeal of William Morris that sprang to mind. He was a childhood hero of Lawrence, and his epic poem was fittingly called The Earthly Paradise. And there we are. Thank you. That's it. I'll just stop sharing. There we are.
There we go. Tony, thank you so much. And friends, now is a wonderful time to be placing your questions either in the Q&A space or into that webinar chat space. I have been seeing some of those as well. We will start actually, we've got some wonderful questions and some very specific questions. So I will let you all decide amongst you who might be the best to answer some of them. But our first question will come from Trish Short-Lewis. Is the Critique of SPW by E.M. Forster available somewhere to read?
Yes, it is. I'll answer that. In fact, I have it in front of me. There is a book called Letters to T.E. Lawrence that was published by his brother Arnold in 1962, I think. And in there is a six pages of Ian Forster's letter to Lawrence in 1924, giving a critique of Seven Pillars of Wisdom. So yes, it is available to read.
There's a good couple of WC questions here. What does it mean about the bathroom that there are no drains? How is water moved about from Toby Walker? And Laura Huffman asked, where actually is the commode in this space? Mm. Not going to pick on any of you, but thank you to whoever chooses this.
When Lawrence was renting the cottage, we know actually in 1929, perhaps in preparation for his mother and brother coming, he did instruct his neighbour to start building a sort of sanitary convenience, he called it, outside somewhere. It might be on the site of, there's a woodshed now, and it might be there, but clearly it disappeared or was taken down at some point. There, his neighbours obviously had an outdoor convenience as well. You could dash over there, it's probably like 50 yards away. and a few acres of ground, as you know, the grounds outside, you know, you can dig a trench and take a spade and do your business.
Linda Taylor Ravel said the same thing. Just use a spade. Or you do have to be really close with your neighbors if you accidentally run into each other in their commode.
But
neighborly relationship to a new level.
Yeah. He was quite contradictory, actually. I think it often depended who he was writing to or who was asking to come and stay, whether he'd say there was access to a toilet or not. You know, he tried and put people off clearly, I think.
I'm talking about the structure itself. Toby Walker asked, when was electricity run into the cottage? There's a vacuum in one of those photographs.
Yes, we are a bit baffled by that.
Yes.
It was probably many years later before electricity was laid on. So why there is a vacuum cleaner in that early photograph, we've never really understood.
We're wondering whether his brother, we know, came and stayed at the cottage, obviously, when Lawrence was lying in a coma, and he stayed on for a few weeks afterwards, obviously looking after Lawrence's affairs. I think these pictures come a bit later, towards the end of that year, or even early 1936. Whether someone came, possibly his mother and brother, and assumed for some reason that there might be electricity there and brought a vacuum cleaner with them to use, and hence it shows in the picture, and they obviously turned up and it's like, oh, no electricity yet, but we're really not sure. It is a bit baffling, it's true.
A question on the swimming pool, a couple of them, so I'm going to try to consolidate. Thank you. This comes from Linda Taylor Ravel as well. Thank you all. Nice to have some of the gaps filled in. She was curious about the swimming pool method to fight the feared heath fires, as was Anne Meyer, who asked, was the reservoir across the road big enough to serve as a swimming pool?
Well, yes, I mean, people did swim in it. Ron swam in it, Patrick Knowles swam in it. So, and not exactly big, but you could do a short length up and down. Apparently it was very, very cold.
The water pool was actually built into the hillside on a sloping ground. And on one side, the wall of the tank was exposed lower down. And Lawrence had a tap fitted that was with a connection for a fire hose. So it was apparently 7,000 gallons of water. And that could be used in the event of a heath fire, which, as Tony said, was a very real possibility. There were heath fires in the 1930s in the area around Cloud Hill and Bovington Army Camp.
And I apologize, someone might have mentioned this. The question has been asked, do we know when the cottage was first built?
Yes, it was 1808. It was originally, in the 19th century, it was a farm labourer's cottage. Most of the time it was used by woodmen employed by the Frampton family, who later on through marriage were actually distant cousins of Lawrence's. Whether he knew that before he came to Dorset, we're not entirely sure, but certainly he discovered it quite quickly that they were cousins of his.
Linda Granfield asks, did Lawrence design the book holder on that lovely armchair? Tony, I think it might have been in one of your pictures.
Mm. Yes, I believe so. I wouldn't put it past him to, fashion something like that. You know, it's quite easily done for someone of his talent. Yeah.
Arthur Decker asks, concerning the Greek inscription above the door, can you remind us what it means and when did he put it up? What was his inspiration for it?
Well, it's translation. It's Greek is ou frontis. It's translation is freely, if in the Australian vernacular, no worries, I suppose you could say today. But yes, it's just from a story of Herodotus' story. So it's basically the intent that going into the cottage, you leave the worries outside.
Mark Edley asks, I wonder, what would Lawrence have thought of all of this interest in his most recent life?
Very good question.
Yes, a very good question. Who can say? You'd like to think partly flattered, partly horrified. That's the way I would look at it.
I think so, yeah.
Could you all expand about what happened to Clouds Hill after Lawrence's death?
Martin, you're best.
Yeah.
Well, as Tony said, his youngest brother, Arnold, moved in. Arnold was actually a professor of archaeology at Cambridge University at the time. It was both Arnold and various other friends who were trying to think of a national memorial to this great hero, decided that one of those memorials should be Clouds Hill and it should be presented to the nation. So Arnold started negotiating with the National Trust, which had actually been set up in 1895, 40 years earlier, and he started negotiating with them to take the cottage on. It actually didn't transfer to them until 1937, but it then opened to the public in 1938. So only 3 years after Lawrence had died, the cottage was open to the public, and it's, apart from the pandemic of the last year or two, it's been open ever since. So that's a brief summary.
A couple of other specific questions. Does the gramophone still function?
No, sadly not. Don't think so. At least we're told not to play it anymore. But
to be clear, that's a really good museum answer. You don't
have
touch
heard
the
it playing.
Object.
I've heard it playing. I think that there is some suggestion, perhaps the mechanism inside was changed for an electric motor at some point, perhaps in the 50s or 60s, and then and it hasn't been restored to its original condition yet. But it's, you know, it'd be nice to get it working again, certainly. It's fantastic.
Could anyone speak to how water was supplied to the cottage? Was it supplied by a well?
Well, there was a spring, and from the spring was a hydraulic ram, which was mentioned in Tony's presentation. The people actually who installed hydraulic rams said it would never work because it was too small, but it did. So I think it used to take, was it 24 hours to fill his header tank, but that would give him enough for his bath. So not exactly a high pressure water supply, but yeah, and it was because the spring would dry up that he was concerned about fires, and then hence the holding of the water in the tank, so that you would always have a water supply, because if it was unreliable, obviously in dry summers.
Anne Meyer asks, in his work, did Hardy mention Clouds Hill anywhere, or possibly by a different name?
Yes, we think so, and certainly Lawrence himself thought so. In The Return of the Native, which describes some woodmen who were living on Egdon Heath in a very similar, not actually the location of Clouds Hill, but in a very similar circumstance, he has a cottage named Mistover Knapp. Now, the Mistover sounds like Clouds Hill, and the Knapp is another name for a hill, so we think Mistover Knapp was inspired by Clouds Hill. Now, Clouds Hill was actually a well-known waypoint on the road between two towns, between Dorchester and Wareham. There was a toll road, and Clouds Hill, as the name of a hill, was actually about halfway along that toll road.
Arthur Decker asks, what was the fate of all of Lawrence's books and phonograph records?
The books were dispersed by, well, that was the one major thing that was in the cottage on his death that was removed by Arnold, his brother. The ultimate fate of all of them. We have somebody listening to this talk, Richard Knowles, who could probably tell you far more about the ultimate fate of any of them. I'm sure he's traced them down.
I think his brother kept a substantial amount, and a lot were auctioned. a lot of Lawrence's photographs, I think either he might have given them to the Imperial War Museum in his lifetime, possibly, Martin.
Yes, that's true. Certainly the negative, yes.
Yeah.
Others can be accessed, that others are held by various bodies like the Bodleian Library, etc. I think his brother Arnold obviously deposited them there later. But yeah, sadly, a lot, you know, just been sold, particularly the books. So they're all around the world now, rather fittingly, I suppose.
In terms of the gramophone records, quite a few of them are actually in storage in an RAF museum. Unfortunately, they're not on display to the public, but they are stored in a museum somewhere.
Friends, any last words for our audience now, or the audience that will be watching in the future on our YouTube channel, which is accessed by www.theworldwar.org?
Well, if anybody is interested in finding out more about Clouds Hill or actually visiting, then you just type in National Trust Clouds Hill in Google and you will get a link to the National Trust website with more details.
Yeah, it's somewhere we always think, it's a place everyone should visit, you know, once in their lifetime at least. And so we're open sort of March to October roughly, but it's all on the website there. And as we mentioned earlier, the T. Lawrence Society is another sort of worthy cause worth joining if you're not already members.
Yeah. And you can find that website right there, linked in the chat already, to go check out how you can get to Clouds Hill and to visit. We certainly encourage it. Tony, Martin, Neill, thank you all so very much. Do check out the T.E. Lawrence Society at www.telsociety.org.uk. And of course, always come and visit us back at the National World War I Museum and Memorial. It is a delight to be in community with this incredible group of global learners and gentlemen. If you aren't seeing this full chat that is kind of exploding with a lot of thanks and a lot of great talk and other really lovely comments, we'll share them with you guys later on. But it is certainly a lot of applause coming back to you all from our audience. And from Haley and I, thank you all so very much. It was a delight to spend an hour with you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Goodbye. Goodbye all.